Hey, John, question for you.
Sure.
So I'm trying to explain to a scientist how they can better develop their methods and in such a way that they can eliminate some of the doubt that can happen with method development and really develop something that they can rely on and trust for some of their more critical assays. And I wanted to bounce some ideas off of you.
Yeah, that sounds great. I mean, as we know, method development isn't the easiest thing in the world to do. Specifically, to develop a good method, there's a lot of moving parts, a lot of variables. Usually it comes down to the stationary phases, which is the column chemistries. What are you thinking?
The first thing I'm thinking of is what is the whole point of method development, right? You're trying to resolve your peaks.
Exactly. Trying to get the widest separation that you can between critical pairs so you can easily identify them, easily quantify them.
Right.
Ah, the old fundamental resolution equation, one of my favorites. So this is really why separation scientists do chromatography. They're trying to pull things apart.
Right.
And this equation shows the three main components that drive resolution: efficiency, retention, and selectivity. And as you can see from the graph, it's all about the selectivity. You know, if you can get more selectivity in a separation, the more likely you are to drive resolution.
Yeah, selectivity is by far the biggest thing that you can adjust when doing method development. And there are a lot of different ways you can do that. You can, as you mentioned before, use a different particle or a different stationary phase, looking at different mobile phase pHs, or looking at even different solvents.
Well, let's start by taking a look at maybe stationary phases. You know, we can look at some base particles, bonded phases. Let's talk about those a little bit.
So obviously chromatography needs a stationary phase. If you're trying to do chromatography with just a union with no packed bed, you're not gonna get very far.
It's a bad idea.
Really bad idea. And all stationary phases are based on a base particle. Something has to be in the packed column to interact with your analytes. And there are a couple of different types of base particles. As you know, we have fully porous particles and we have solid pore particles. And with solid pore particles, you have that non-porous middle part, looks kind of like a weird M&M. And then you have the outer layer, which is fully porous. And that's where a lot of your interactions can happen.
Yeah, and it's the attributes of these base particles that can help drive certain separations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, fully porous is fine, and so isn't superficially porous or solid core, right? They both have attributes that can be desired for methods development.
Exactly. So things like loadability studies, or if you're going up to a prep scale, obviously a fully porous will be a little bit better because of the loadability aspects of it.
Exactly.
But solid core particles have higher efficiency because they have that solid centerpiece.
So if you're trying to go fast, all about throughput, solid core is a good way to go.
Exactly.
Now, what about particle morphology? You know, whether it's silica-based or hybrid-based, what do you know about those?
So silica and hybrid technologies are a little different, obviously, because based on the name. Hybrid particles generally have what's called a bridged ethyl group embedded in the lattice structure of the silica. As you can see here, we have silica structures and that bridged ethyl hybrid, which is what we call our acuity VEH particle, in the structures. What this does is this provides a lot of pH stability and temperature stability for these particles compared to silica, especially when dealing with high pH mobile phases, so basic mobile phases.
Exactly, and silica is still a really good support, right? It's really a good base particle, but hybrids give you that extra attribute of being able to use elevated pH, which, as we know, can change the ionization of certain analytes, make them more hydrophobic, make them more hydrophilic, which can help them in their selectivity, right? Drive their overall retentivity,
yep.
Which is important.
Yeah, and silica has a little bit of an advantage too at low pH because there's more silanol activity on the surface of these particles, which can interact with some of your analytes, especially if you're dealing with polar analytes. A little bit better retention for these pure silica particles compared to hybrids.
Exactly right. So never, ever, ever expect two base particles from two different manufacturers to be exactly the same.
Exactly.
Right? There are all these little subtle differences that, again, if you're aware of, can really help you drive your separation and give you some confidence in what you're trying to do.
Exactly. It's always good to look at different types of base particles when doing method development, just because you never know if that's going to play a role in your separation.
Now, on top of these base particles, Kenny, we can put what I like to call the flavors or the chemistries. You know, you can use that same base particle, but put maybe a hydrophobic or a hydrophilic moiety on top of that to help manipulate selectivity even further.
Yep.
Can you talk a little bit about some of those stationary phase ligands?
Yeah, so there's a lot of them. So the most popular column chemistries that I've seen in looking at peer review papers really boils down to these seven. You have your C18, which is your bread and butter, good go-to column to start with.
Everybody loves the C18, Kenny.
It's a great place to start. And a lot of columns actually are based on the C18 stationary phase, like the Atlantis Premier BEH C18AX column, which uses the C18 and a mixed mode functional group as well.
Yep.
Then we have something a little bit less hydrophobic, like the C8, which is really good if you have sticky analytes, so like plastic additives or maybe some of the fat-soluble vitamins, things like that.
Yep.
The next one is the Shield RP18, which is kind of like a C18. The difference is it has an embedded carbamate group in that ligand structure, and that helps bring in some of the water closer to the base particle and helps retain polar analytes.
Yeah, that's interesting. I've seen some of these embedded polar functionalities before, right? And they just, again, add a difference in selectivity, which, again, can help drive separation or resolution. And also, they're really good, in this case, to be used in their neutral pH, kind of cover up some of those surface silanols that make the surface a little bit more acidic.
Exactly, yep. Other popular phases are things like cyanos, pentafluoral or fluorophenols, where you have a phenyl ring and a whole bunch of fluorines attached to it. And then, of course, the phenylhexyl stationary phase is also very, very good in a lot of different things.
Yeah, for definitely driving those pi to pi bond interactions, that phenyl functionality can really promote some additional separation or resolution characteristics.
Exactly. And it's not only about what chemistry is attached to the base particle, but how it's attached to that base particle. So some things like, is it monofunctionally or trifunctionally bonded, can have a really big impact on the stability of the phase, which we're going to talk about in another episode, and also the end capping. So once we've attached to this column chemistry, what do we do after that? Do we just leave it? Do we do something else to it? There's a lot of little things that can happen that all can affect selectivity.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, based on what we know about bonded phases and base particles, you know, if you really want to manipulate or maximize that selectivity space, it's good to have a nice mixture of different base particles and different bonded phases, because that's going to give you that really wide selectivity range that's going to really, again, show you how things move around and maybe get you that resolution that you need to meet your goals.
Exactly. Yep. And that's just one of the many things you can do to affect selectivity. We're going to talk more about them in a future episode.
Yeah.
But that's just the start.
Do we have any good references as to where some of our scientists can go to learn more about this?
Yeah, we have a lot of application notes on the Waters website looking at method development. I've written a few. I think you've written a couple as well.
Yeah.
So there's definitely resources out there, and not only just from us, but from other vendors as well. Method development is a huge area that a lot of people have challenges with.
So Kenny, really understanding that base particle and that bonded phase and those attributes that they bring to methods development is really important. You know, it gives you some confidence and some trust when you're trying to develop your method as to what those types of functionalities are going to do for your separation.
Exactly. And getting a method and a separation that you can trust really makes things a lot easier when you're doing assays down the road.